Welcome back, my dear learner. It's been a long demand from most of my students who has watched my revision lectures on YouTube or on the live webinar that the missing portion of time of supply would be made out of a video so that the entire revision program would be complete. If you have not watched the revision program, I'll strongly request you to go through all the 7 videos. And this particular session would be considered to be the video you have to watch right before session number 4. So let me put you through what agenda I have for discussion today. So in this particular video, I'm going to explain the concept of time of supply to you. So most of them has requested me that they wanted to get that full understanding on time of supply, and to have full understanding on that particular video, I would be discussing following points in this particular session. What is time of supply? I would also discuss the concept of time of supply in section 12 and section 13, and what is the division of section and how it is being done, the logical aspect of it. Plus, I'll discuss what is time of supply in forward charge cases for supplier of goods and supplier of services. These are the concepts that I'm going to discuss in this particular session. Make sure that after you read through this particular session, you have to go through all other sessions in my YouTube channel to get full clarity on the subject. There is 20 to 21 hours of lectures available free of cost in YouTube. Make sure that you use it wisely for your upcoming July-August examination, be it CA or CWA or CS examinations. So this syllabus intend to cover intermediate level in all the professional courses. Now let me get you an understanding on time of supply. To give you clarity on time of supply, I have to give you some basics on periodicity of payment of GST. So let's have quick discussion on that. What is the periodicity in which GST has to be paid to the government? I'm precisely not asking you the case of composition levy scheme. So other than CLS, other than composition levy scheme, what is the periodicity in which one has to pay GST to the government? Now, because in composition levy scheme, the tax computation generally works based on the turnover. Thereby, the time of supply provisions will have less relevance when it comes to composition levy scheme. So if you want to understand what is composition levy scheme, I'll recommend you to watch session number 3 in my YouTube channel. Now, periodicity of payment of GST is on monthly basis, which means that as and when a month ends, I have to sum up all my GST payable and I'll have to remit it to government. Now, the next question would be, who has to remit this particular payment to the government? The understanding is very simple. The payment has to be remitted based on what charge is applicable to that particular transaction. Now, what do you mean by what charge is applicable to that transaction? Let me take you an example, a very basic example for your understanding. Say, you're going to Kentucky Fried Chicken. You're going to KFC to purchase a bucket chicken. That is the product that you're planning to consume. Now, you went there and they have given you a bill of 1,000 rupees. Of course, they'll add GST on that, which is, say, for example, they've added 5%. So 1,050 is the bill that you have received for Kentucky Fried Chicken. Now, very importantly, that you will have to understand, this particular 1,050 rupees goes from your pocket to the seller. So, but in that particular 1,050, 50 rupees portion is GST. Whether you would directly remit this GST to government or you remit it to the seller. The understanding is very clear. You remit it to the seller. So this particular method of payment is called as forward charge mechanism. So as and when forward charge mechanism is applicable, the tax will be paid by the recipient, the customer, the recipient to the seller, who is called as supplier in GST. So generally The tax to the government is paid by the supplier. So they'll collect from you and they'll pay to the government. So the mechanism in which supplier pays GST to the government is called as forward charge mechanism. Now, that is not the only concept we have. We do have one more concept in which tax will be paid, which we call it as reverse charge mechanism. In such mechanism, it will be the recipient who pays the taxes to the government. So in certain cases, government finds it easier to get the taxes directly from the customer or the recipient. In such cases, government has put in a provision in section 9 subsection 3 and 9 subsection 4. If you refer that provision, it says that in the selected cases by the government, in such provisions, it is the recipient who is liable to pay taxes to the government. To give you a very simple example and refer back to 9 subsection 3, notification 13/2017, where they are listing out the cases. Referring back to a very simple example, say for example, State Bank of India has appointed you as a recovery agent to collect the long pending loan of State Bank of India from one of their customers. With all your effort, you could gather the loan 50%. Say for example, the loan was 1 crore, you tried your best and got 50 lakhs from the borrower and you've remitted this amount to State Bank of India. What is the capacity in which you're working? Are you an employee? You're not an employee. You're under contract of service. And in such cases, you're eligible for a commission, which is the consideration for the recovery agent service you have provided. Now, government has said in such cases, the recovery agent is the supplier and bank is the recipient. But in such cases, for the government, it is easier to track down the bank. Thereby, it will be the responsibility of the bank to pay the taxes to the government. Thereby, reverse charge mechanism is applicable in such cases. So, we cannot directly say who is liable to pay GST to government unless we know what charge is applicable to that particular transaction. So, to sum up this particular discussion, we can say that periodicity of payment of GST to government is on monthly basis. But whether it is paid by supplier or it is paid by recipient depends upon what charge is there. So, if it's forward charge mechanism, the tax liability goes to supplier. If it is reverse charge mechanism, tax liability goes to recipient itself. Plus, both of them, whenever they pay, the periodicity is monthly. That is more relevant in case of time of supply discussion. Now, in India, I cannot just simply say it is to be paid on monthly basis. I also have to ensure what is the due date in which I'll have to remit it. And if I don't remit within the due date, there should be some kind of a penalization. Now, they have said in GST provision, every month, the tax liability has to be remitted to government within 20th of subsequent month. So what is the due date of payment of this particular GST? It has to be paid on or before 20th of subsequent month, which means that if it is January GST, it has to be paid to the government on or before 20th of February. If it is February payment, it is to be paid on or before 20th of March. If it is March payment, it is to be paid on or before 20th of April. What if I pay on 25th? Will they arrest me? No. You will have to be penalized. What is the penalization for late payment of taxes? It is interest. So you will have to pay beyond 20th with an interest of 18% per annum. This is the understanding you have. Now, there is always a conceptual clarity when it comes to few terms that I find with students. So I have decided to clarify you certain terms. Now, there is always a differentiation between the amount that you pay to the government. So you will pay multiple amounts to the government and I can classify them into four categories. One is tax amount. As a taxpayer, you can pay tax amount, which is GST. Now, when you delay the payment of GST beyond the due date, you will pay together with GST an interest. Like the interest I was mentioning, generally at 18%. Now, when you have filed this particular return on due date, there is no problem that happens. But if you don't file the documents, that is the returns, within the due date, you will have to pay beyond the due date an additional payment called as late fee for delayed filing of returns. So generally, late fee is associated with delayed filing of returns. Now, if you contravene any provisions in the sections of GST law, you will have some liability that is coming up, which is called as penalty. So penalty is generally associated with contravention of provision of law. So if this is clear to you, let me take an example and then try to explain you how to compute interest. I'll read the question for you. Mr. Ram, a registered supplier, has made outward supply in the month of December 2019 for a value of 16 lakhs. And I'm requesting you to compute three things. What are the three things I want you to compute? First, I want you to compute what is the GST payable by Mr. Ram. Also, what is the due date of payment and total amount payable if payment was made on 23rd March 2020. Can I go ahead? First one, if GST payable, if the tax rate is 12%, 16 lakh is the value, 12% if I apply, I'll get 1,92,000 as the tax payable. Now, what was the month in which I provided the service? It was in December 2019, which means that what will be the due date? It will become 20th of January 2020, next month 20th, that is the due date. But did I pay within the due date? The answer is no, because actual payment happened on 23rd of March 2020. In such cases, there is a delay. So what is that? I have to pay in addition to the tax amount, I will have to pay interest. How do I compute interest? First, I should know how many days of delay that has been caused by this late payment. When was the due date? 20th of January. Did I pay in January? No. Which means how many days of delay in January? Ignore 20th, add another 11 days. So 11 days of delay in January. February, did I pay? No. Which means it's a leap year. So 29 days delay in February. None. March, when did I pay? 23rd. I have to add even 23rd. So 23rd, 3 days in March. So 11 plus 29 plus 23. Totally, I have delay of 63 days for payment of taxes. If that's the case, what's the general rate of interest that was applicable? It is 18%. So interest would be 1,92,000 multiplied with 18% multiplied with 63 days divided by 366, which means I have to pay an interest of 5,949 rupees, which means that instead of paying just 1,92,000 if I had paid within the due date, if I'm paying on 23rd March, I'll end up with paying 1,97,949. Are you guys clear on this particular concept? Okay. Now let's quickly jump into the concept of time of supply. So time of supply comes up with few understanding on few transaction. So let me make understanding on few transaction based on few example I've already charted out. Let's take an example on supply of goods and supply of service. I'm going to chart out a transaction. Mr. Shahul is a supplier. He's a supplier of goods. And what is the periodicity for supplier of goods? Monthly. Supplier of service? Monthly. Forward charge? Monthly. Reverse charge? Monthly. Periodicity is fixed. He provided certain goods to VKC, which is a company who is the recipient. What he did is that he delivered those particular goods on August 10, 2019. So raw material has been delivered on August 10, 2019. Now what is that he has to do after he delivers? He has to bill them. So he issued the invoices. Is it mandatory that he has to issue the invoice on the same day? Not necessarily. So he issued the invoices on October 5th, which means he has issued the invoice after 2 months. Then he made payment on 10th of December 2019, which means that the payment happened in December month. Now my question to you is this: what is the due date of payment for this particular transaction for Shahul, who is the supplier? What is the periodicity? Monthly. So I will have to pay on or before 20th of subsequent month. What is the problem that we find in this particular case? The problem is that instead of 1 month, in this particular example, I have 3 months which are relevant for the given transaction. So when you have more than 1 month relevant for the given transaction, how do you determine what is the due date? So for determining the due date, you should know when is the date of this particular supply. So I have to decide between date of delivery, date of invoice, date of payment, I have to pick one date and call that as date of supply or time of supply. To give you a little more understanding, you will have to pick one date and call it as date of supply. If I pick the date as date of delivery, then August 10th becomes the date of supply. Then what will be the due date of payment? 20th of subsequent month. If instead of that, if I pick date of issue of invoices, then October becomes the time of date of supply. Next month will become the due date. So the process is very simple. You will have to pick a date and you will call that as date of supply or time of supply. What's the relevance of that particular date? Based on that date, you will have a due date of payment of taxes to the government. Are you guys clear? Is this going to be there only for supply of goods? Not necessarily. Same transaction can happen in case of supply of service also. Say Shahir is a supplier of service. He has completed the audit in August, issued the invoice in October, and received the payment in December from State Bank of India. So the same problem can happen in case of service as well. Here Shahir has to pick a date out of 3 months and then decide one of them to be time of supply, pay the taxes next month 20th. Now instead of Shahir being as auditor, if he's a recovery agent, this activity has to be done for SBI because they are the ones who are paying taxes to the government. I hope I'm clarifying this particular concept of time of supply to all of you. So the whole process of time of supply is picking a date and then deciding what will be the date on which tax has to be paid to the government. Are you guys clear? Okay, wonderful. Now, let me give you an overview of the sections that we have for time of supply. Time of supply has been discussed over three different sections in CGST Act. Section 12, Section 13, Section 14. Section 14 talks about effective rate. When change in effective rate happens, what will be the time of supply? This is a discussion for CA final, not applicable for intermediate. So I'm not covering this in this particular lecture. Now my concentration is on Section 12 and Section 13. Section 12 talks about how to determine time of supply for supply of goods, wherein Section 13 talks about how to determine time of supply for supply of service. Let me quickly jump through. Now, one very important point that you need to understand is that it is very easy to pick the subsection because subsection structure of Section 12, Section 13 are same. Section 12 has 5 relevant subsection for us. Section 13 also has 5 relevant subsection. 12 subsection 1 talks about time of supply of goods will be determined under this section. 13 subsection 1 also says time of supply for service is determined under this section. So subsection 1 is not something that we are going to discuss. Subsection 2 onwards we can discuss. Subsection 2 talks about how to determine time of supply for supplier, and subsection 3 talks about how to determine time of supply for recipient. How subsection 4 talks about how to determine time of supply when you have a vouchers exchangeable for goods or service. Subsection 5 talks about residual cases. Subsection 6 talks about how to determine time of supply when there is an enhanced consideration by way of interest, late fee, penalty, etc. Now, what is the meaning of the sentence when I say subsection structure is same? Let me explain you that. Subsection 2 in Section 12 says how to determine time of supply for supplier of goods. 13 subsection 2 says how to determine time of supply for supplier of service. Now 12 subsection 3 says that if there is reverse charge comes for supply of goods, how to determine time of supply for recipient of goods. So if that's the case, what is 13 subsection 3 would be like? It will be how to determine time of supply for recipient of service when reverse charge applicable. Now vouchers, when vouchers are exchangeable for goods, 12 subsection 4. Exchange for service, then it will be 13 subsection 4. 5 residual cases of goods in 12.5 and residual case of service in 13.5. Enhanced consideration in goods, 12.6, service, 13.6. This is the structure. Now let us look at subsection 2 of both section 12 subsection 2 and 13 subsection 2. I have a global chart which will make you understand the whole concept in full. This is the whole chart that I have for you to determine time of supply. But before I get into the chart, let me give you an overall understanding of time of supply and logical method in which how can you pick the time of supply. Generally, you will have to decide time of supply in a logical sense. What is the logic that I'm giving you? This is the thumb rule. Who is paying taxes first you decide? Forward charge supplier, reverse charge recipient. So first you decide who is paying taxes. Once you decide that, you check what is the event in which he has control over. Supply is over. Supplier has two more events to finish. Issue the invoice, receive the money. What is the event supplier has control? Issuing invoice. Again, I repeat, supply is over. Now, he has two events with him. Issuing invoice, receiving payment. He has control over invoice. That will be his time of supply generally. But if I keep it as time of supply, what is the risk that the government has? When I say I give it, I mean government gives it. When government gives date of invoice as time of supply, what is the risk that the government has? That somebody can delay the payment of taxes by delaying their invoicing. So they said, no, let me compare it with one more date. What is that date? Let me compare it with due date of invoice. Let me fix a due date of invoice. Now, this is the mechanism in which the time of supply has been determined for supplier in all cases. Date of invoice, due date of invoice. We will have to make a comparison. Now, when it comes to recipient, what is the event he has control over? Invoice or payment? Payment, because recipient always makes the payment. So that will be the general time of supply. But what is the risk government has? He can delay the payment. So payment, due date of payment. Are you understanding the basic concept? Now, time of supply for supplier under forward charge mechanism is what I'm going to discuss. I told you, in case of goods, it will be 12 subsection 2. And I've told you the basics also. So generally, what will be the time of supply? Date of invoice. So 12 subsection 2 says, time of supply for supplier of goods would be earlier of the following dates. A, date of invoice or due date of invoice under section 31. Earlier it was saying 31.1. They have amended it. Now they're saying only section 31. So, date of invoice or due date of invoice under section 31. Or you have to compare it with date of receipt of payment. Now, very important point you will have to understand. You will have to look at the notification I have given there. It says, this date of receipt of payment has been omitted by notification 66/2017 for cases other than composition levy scheme. Which means that right now, you don't need to consider date of receipt of payment for supplier of goods to determine time of supply. So what is the part that you will consider? You will only consider this part, because the other part is omitted. But is it amended in the section? It is not. So in an examination perspective, you will have to write that and say that it is omitted. So you'll have to remember notification 66/2017. This is one notification. I'll strongly recommend you to remember this notification number also. This is one case. Then, what is the impact of this particular provision? Impact is this. Since this particular date of receipt of payment is omitted, they have already said whichever is earlier. So when date of receipt of payment is earlier, which means that you are receiving payment even before invoice and due date of invoice, which means it is an advance payment. So if this particular provision was there, then on advance payment, this date of receipt of payment becomes the time of supply. Now, since this is omitted, the impact is even if payment is received in advance, time of supply will be determined under this particular clause 12.2a, which means even if the advance is received, if you are a supplier of goods, you have to pay your taxes only upon when you invoice or what is the due date of invoice. Are you guys understanding? Now let's quickly look at what is the due date of invoice. Due date of invoice under section 31 subsection 1. 31 has multiple cases in which you will determine due date, which I had discussed in the lectures otherwise. Now, 31 subsection 1, let me discuss the basic case here. Due date of invoice under section 31.1 for supply of goods. You will have to first ask this question, whether supply involves movement of goods. If the answer is yes, due date of invoice is date of removal of goods for supply. If the answer is no, which means supply does not involve movement of goods. In such cases, due date of invoice is date of delivery of goods or making goods available to recipient. And making goods available to recipient comes if delivered unfinished or unassembled. Now, reading the provision is little dry. I understand that and accept that particular fact. Now, we will have to make it very interesting by analyzing it with the logic. I will walk you through an example. You decided to get a new phone. Now, you're going to the shop. You're wearing your mask and gloves, carrying a sanitizer with you, and you're walking into the showroom. Say, for example, you're going to this showroom in Kerala called as Myji. Now, you started looking into each of the form. Now, the context in which we are discussing this is when should the invoices be issued. So, you're looking into one form or the other form. You keep looking into that. After you look into this particular form, you decided to purchase one form. You told that particular person, I'll purchase tomorrow. You walk out of that shop. Whether you should be given an invoice, the answer is no. But while you're walking, you're carrying the form. Whether you should be given an invoice, yes, that becomes the proof that you can show to the security. So generally, what is the due date of issuing invoices? That is when you deliver the goods. But instead of buying from that particular showroom, you went there and checked the specification, looked at Amazon in your phone and ordered it from Bangalore. Now the Bangalore fellow who's sitting there is packaging that particular product and then sending it across to you. Now, can he issue the invoices once it reaches, the courier reaches your house? The answer is no, because he has to hand it over to someone else. Because of that, he has to issue the invoices the moment he is giving the goods from his factory or shop or wherever he is in. So the question is whether that particular goods involves transportation, or the logical question that the section asks is whether the supply involves movement of goods. If the answer is yes, then due date of invoice is date of removal of goods for supply. If the answer is no, then due date of invoice is date of delivery of goods or making goods available to recipient. So if supply involves movement means there is transportation involved, then your due date becomes date on which you are taking it from your factory and then giving it, or taking it from your shop and then giving it. But it does not involve movement, which means that you're coming, your customer is coming to your shop and purchasing it. Then your due date of invoice will become the date on which you are handing over the goods to him. Now, if at all you are going to his house and then constructing the goods, then you will have to issue the invoice only when you finish the construction and making it available. So if it is delivered unfinished or unassembled, then your due date will be the date on which you finish that particular assembly. Now, let me put an example question for your understanding. Mr. Ram, a dealer in Calicut, has made an order to purchase shoes on 18th August with VKC Limited. VKC Limited manufactured the shoes and informed Mr. Ram on 25th August. Mr. Ram collected the goods at the showroom of VKC on 8th September. Invoice for the same was issued by VKC Limited on 5th September. Mr. Ram made payment for the same on 6th September. Determine time of supply and due date of payment of taxes to government for VKC. Would your answer be different if the payment was made in advance by Mr. Ram on 18th of August itself? Would your answer be different? Now you will have to understand certain aspects here. I want you to pause the video here, read that particular question at your end once. Okay, now that you have read the question, let us quickly look at the answer. So first, any question in time of supply, you will have to first decide the section. How do you decide the section? Ask whether it is goods or service. Shoes, goods. So section 12. Forward charge, reverse charge. We never learned anything about reverse charge under shoes. So 12 subsection 2 is the section. So we pick the section very easily. Now, 12 subsection 2 says that your time of supply would be date of invoice or due date of invoice under section 31. Now, what is due date of invoice? You have to ask the question whether supply involves movement of goods or not. It says that Mr. Ram collected the goods at the showroom of VKC, which means that the customer is coming to your showroom and collecting, which means that there is no movement, which means your due date of invoice is 8th of September itself. Date of delivery. Now, when did you issue the invoice? Invoice for the same was issued by VKC on 5th of September. Now, date of invoice compared with due date of invoice, whichever is earlier. What is the earlier one? 5th of September will be the time of supply. So you will have to first write the provision, then write that particular answer in this particular case. So the presentation is very important. First, you have to write the entire provision in sentences. Then you will have to write date of invoice is equal to 5th September. Due date of invoice is equal to 8th September. Time of supply is earlier of the above, which is 5th of September. Now you will have to write date of receipt of payment, but it is omitted. In bracket you will have to write it is omitted because of notification 66/2017. Now would your answer be different? Instead of payment receiving on 6th September, you got the payment on 18th of August, which means that you got advance payment. Will your answer be different? No. Reason: date of receipt of payment is omitted in computing time of supply in case of supplier of goods. You will have to tell that particular answer also. So since it is omitted in notification 66/2017, your time of supply would remain as 5th of September, even if payment is received in advance on 18th of August. That will be the answer. Now let's quickly look at the time of supply provision in case of services. For supplier of service, what will be the section? Section 13, forward charge, section 13, subsection 2. Same set of question only you are going to ask, whether invoice is issued within the due date or not. This is the question you are going to ask. Now, what is the due date we had in case of goods? We had asked the question whether in supply involves movement or not and all that. Now, but in this particular case, we don't ask that particular question. Instead, we ask this question, whether invoice is issued within 30 days from the date of provision of services. If invoice is issued within 30 days from the date of provision of services, then we would say that it is issued within the due date. If the answer is yes, then time of supply would be earlier of date of invoice or date of receipt of payment. If the answer is no, then time of supply would be earlier of date of provision of services or date of receipt of payment. This is the case that we have. Okay. Now let me explain you this with a very simple example. As a supplier of service, if you have completed the service, that is called as date of provision of service. Within how many days you will have issued the invoice? Within 30 days. If you have issued within 30 days, then your date of invoice will become the time of supply. Or you have to compare it with date of receipt of payment. If advance payment is received, then that date of payment or date of receipt of advance will become the time of supply. Here it is not omitted because it is taken from service tax, and service tax also said the same. If advance is received by a supplier of service, then that date will become the time of supply. Now, if you don't even issue the invoice within 30 days, instead of invoice date, you compare it with the provision date, with payment date, whichever is earlier, that will become the time of supply. Now, this 30 days provision will become 45 days in case of few certain companies. Never tested in the exam, it can be tested in case of banking company, insurance company, financial institution including NBFC. Instead of 30 days, you have to take 45 days. This is the understanding that we have about provisions. So the example for this particular provision, you can refer to session 4 in the YouTube channel, that I have explained you all other provisions relating to time of supply there, including the examples for service cases for supplier of service. I really hope this makes our lectures complete. If you have any doubts, make sure that you write to me on my email ID, or you can connect to me over my Facebook, Instagram, or Twitter, or LinkedIn channels. Also, if you wanted to get similar videos, all the updates, do make sure that you subscribe to this particular channel and keep sharing it to your friends, and do support and I wish you all the very best for your examination.